hear the music I'm playing? I realized, y'all.
No.
No.
I messaged you.
I'm like, what are we doing?
Sorry, I was jamming out to music. The revolution will not be televised. I apologize. I will stop the share again real quick and reshare. Can y'all hear it now? All right, we will be getting started in 1 minute. Sorry about that.
You will not be able to stay home, brother. You will not be able to plug in, turn on, and cop out. You will not be able to lose yourself on Skag and skip out for beer during commercials because the revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be brought to you by...
Hi, y'all. Can you guys hear me? Well, I didn't know what was happening for a second.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm gonna assume yes. Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm V. I use she, her pronouns. I'm an organizer at SEJ. And we're so excited for you all to be here. Our members have worked really hard on this event, and we're excited that you guys are here to share the love and share the wisdom. So this is Untold Stories, Young Leaders of the Revolution. And as our check-in, we would like it if you could all, in the chat, put in your name, your preferred pronouns, and answer the question, if you could have dinner with any historical figure, who would it be? I'll start. My name is V. I use she, her pronouns. And if I could have dinner with anyone, I think that it would be, I don't know. The entirety of like the original, like SEIU, like female organizers in like, I watched this documentary a while ago and it was about women organizers who were fighting for like labor rights. So all of them, honestly. Can you go to the next slide, Brianna? As context as to who we are Students for Educational Justice or SEJ. Sorry, the slides are frozen for me. But we are a grassroots youth-led intergenerational organization in New Haven. And we do organizing for the sake of racial and educational justice. And we also have programming to cultivate self-pride in young BIPOC, which stands for Black, Indigenous, and Young People of Color. You can learn more about SEJ on all of our social media, amazing QR codes here. Follow us on Instagram. Our social media people, Kira and Ike, who are here tonight, make amazing content for Instagram. And they have been highlighting Black History Month all month. So follow us on social media. And I just wanna recognize all of the chats. Hi, everybody. Terrell, Janaya, Georgia. Ravi, hi, Isabel, Whitney, amazing. Brianna, can you go to the next slide? So we want to kind of just be all on the same page about how tonight is gonna work. We're so grateful for you guys to all be here, but we all also wanna be on the same page. If everyone can mute themselves if they're not speaking, and also use the raise hand feature, which you can find on the bottom if you go on reactions and then click reactions and then raise hand. That way it'll move up on the screen and we'll see if you have a question or if you have a certain response that you really want to say. This is a safe and brave space, which means that you're allowed to ask questions and you're allowed to not know what's going on. You're allowed to need clarification. If someone said something that you want to be said again, like ask in the chat and someone will respond. We are not judging you. No one here is judging anything that you say. This is a safe space. We also really encourage the use of the chat to hype everyone up. I love using the chat to hype people up. So everyone should use the chat. And also if you hear someone that you really vibe with and like wanna get to know them, use the chat and connect with people. Another important one is take space, make space, which means that if you notice that, you know, in the past you're a quiet person or like you don't have a lot to say sometimes, but you do like have thoughts, go ahead and use the chat, raise your hand, say, you know, share your opinions. But at the same time, if you notice that you are speaking a lot or you are taking up a lot of space in the chat, take a step back and create space for other people, encourage others to speak. And finally, this is a youth-created event, and it's about young people. So especially if you are an adult, please recognize the space that you're taking up and hype our young people up, because young people are leading the space. Thank you. Okay.
Hi. Good evening. My name is Rashonda McCullum, and I am the Executive Director of Students for Educational Justice. Again, thank you all for joining us tonight. I'm super excited for you to be a part of this event. As V mentioned, this entire event was completely came out of the minds of our student members. And so it was developed by them. They took the time to do the research for the presentations that you're going to see tonight, and they're showcasing their art. So what the night will look like is we will begin with a presentation of young activists. So each of the people who present today have selected a young activist or group of activists that they wanted to research and then present for you all. And then we will have some student performances. So this is a time where they will completely open themselves up to you all by sharing their art with you, which, you know, is very, you know, special. And so I'm just super excited for that. And then finally, we will end the latter part of tonight's event with a conversation. This is your turn, time to be engaged with the students who created this event. They will be talking amongst themselves, but also inviting the audience to join in. And so, without further ado, we are going to start with a poll. So the poll question is, how are you feeling today? Are you excited? You're just good? You're okay? Or is it like, look, I don't even have pants on right now? So I invite you all to just quickly take this poll. And then we'll just see how folks are doing. Rihanna, whenever you're ready, because you can see the results, you can see how many people participated. All right, well, that's good. The majority of us are excited. A good number of us are good. Okay, and you know what? I don't blame you for not having pants on, so that's fine. All right, so we do have another quick poll question for you. Brianna, hit it. All right, so our second question is, how would you rate your knowledge of Black history in America? So number one is, I don't know anything. Like, no one ever taught me. I don't know anything. Two is, you know, I know a couple things. I picked some things up here and there. Three, I only remember the limited amount that was taught to me in grade school. Four, I take the opportunity to learn as much as I can. And five, I could practically teach this. So everybody, if you just take a minute and weigh in. And then Bree, like I said, you can see when people are done. So, oh, okay. All right, so we're starting from a good point of view. We have no one said I don't know anything, which is great because literally Google exists. And so if you know nothing, then there's problems. Two, I know a couple things. Okay, we got 14% that said that, 5% who just remember the limited amount that was taught in grade school. And then the majority of us take the opportunity to learn as much as we can, which is awesome. And then we have 9% who could practically teach this. And that's great too. I hope that is some of our members who selected that, because they will be teaching this tonight. all right. And so at this point, we're gonna go ahead and begin with our presentation. Our first presenter is Ike Apayomi, and she will be presenting on the Little Rock Nine. Go ahead, Ike.
Hi, my name is EK. I use she, they pronouns, and I'm a freshman at Jonathan Law High School. And we're starting off with Little Rock Nine, which is the statue that you see in there. So the Little Rock Nine was a group of African-American students who did many great things, and it consisted of Thelma, Mothershed Ware, Minnie Jean Brown Tricky, Jefferson Thomas, Terrence Roberts, Carlotta Walls Lanier, Gloria Ray Carmark, Ernest Green, Elizabeth Eckford, and Melba Petillo Bales. So after the U.S. ruled segregation unconstitutional, many areas protested this and continued to be segregated despite the U.S. government denying that and trying to be desegregated in many cities. So one of the places that protested the U.S. ruling segregation unconstitutional is Little Rock, Arkansas, which is what Little Rock Nine derived from, and it's also the capital of Arkansas. So in order to desegregate the schools, the NAACP organized Little Rock Nine, which was a group of African-American students, like I mentioned before, who were going to like plan and go into the schools in order to desegregate and start change. So they basically chose students who were determined and strong and put them through intensives to prepare them for going into the schools and like sort of facing racism and things like that. So on September 4th, 1957, in Central High School in Little Arkansas, or Little Rock, Arkansas, on the first day of classes, they went into the school with, and they faced many white protesters who were mad that they were there. And actually the governor of Arkansas at the time, Orville Febus, actually called the Arkansas National Guard to block them from entering. But later in the month, the president at the time, who was President Eisenhower, sent in federal troops to escort them into the school. And I really like the story. And also their story brings up an important purpose and significance. And it hopes, or it brings a sense of hope and also persistence to keep going. And later, many graduated, but the one person who was Minnie Jean Brown couldn't take the pressure of racism that they were facing in the school, which was very high at the time due to like segregation and things like that. So she actually had to go to a school in New York in order to sort of recover and like do better and stuff like that.
Thank you, EK. What a great presentation on the Little Rock Nine. Next, we have
I'm Anthony Mitchell. I'm a senior at Common Ground High School in New Haven. Excuse me if I glitch a little. My internet connection is kind of like wavering right now, but it's staying strong, which I like. So I'm going to be talking about Fred Hampton, who is a Illinois native. He was born in Summit, Illinois, and soon would move with his parents to Chicago. Growing up, he saw a lot of violence in the Black. Was black on black, and so he grew up with the mentality of, if I'm not going to fix this issue, who is? So as a teenager, as a youth, he led a local NAACP chapter in Illinois that after his leadership grew up to about more than 500 people. He would later go to study pre-law at Tristan College in hopes of kind of stopping police brutality against the Black community. He would also join the Black Panther Party and rise to the position of deputy chair of the National Party. Influence, he decided that it was time to make some act. So he helped enact the free breakfast program in Chicago to give free breakfast to kids who couldn't afford it. He used influence to stop rivalries between Black and Puerto Rican gangs in Chicago. And at this time, he was devoted to the Black Panther Party and was seen as a radical, which was a good thing and a bad thing, because sooner or later he would be perceived as a threat by the federal government, and they would have to take action as to actually send a raid into the Black Panther headquarters in Illinois and actually assassinate him while he's sleeping. And this happened in 1969, and the world lost a great important figure at that time. But as he said before, you can kill a revolutionary, but you can't kill off the revolution. The fact that even the tallest voice can have great potential to be a great threat and danger to everyone if it's not taken seriously. And so that's why I decided to talk about him today.
Thank you, Anthony. Next, we have Brianna Mondesir, who will be presenting on Akua Njeri.
Hi, everyone. My name is Brianna, as Rashonda said. I am a 2018 graduate of Cooperative Arts and Humanities High School located in downtown New Haven, Connecticut. And today I will be talking about Akua Njeri, formerly known as Deborah Johnson. Akua Njeri is an American poet, revolutionary, and former influential member of the Illinois chapter of the Black Panther Party. She was a fiance of Fred Hampton and the mother of Fred Hampton Jr. Njeri had participated in social justice work and revolutionary striving since the age of 12 years old. She participated in marches and protests against housing conditions in Chicago. Later on, during her time as a student at Wilbur Wright College and as a member of the Black Student Union, she attended a talk that included Fred Hampton. Njeri and Hampton struck up a conversation after the talk, and there was an instant connection created between them. She would go on to become an integral member of the Illinois chapter of the Black Panther Party and Fred Hampton's life. She assisted with a free breakfast program, the free medical clinic, and the free prison busing program for families of the incarcerated. During her time with the Black Panthers, Njeri and Hampton started dating, and Njeri became pregnant with Fred Hampton Jr. shortly thereafter. Following the events on December 4th, 1969, when police officers raided the Black Panther headquarters and killed two individuals, one of them being Fred Hampton, Njeri was left a widow and single mother. At the time, she was nearly 9 months pregnant and 19 years old. However, despite the atrocities she faced, she never discontinued her fight for justice. Along with her son, Fred Hampton Jr., Njeri is still intimately involved with the Black Panthers Cubs movement and raising awareness about Fred Hampton's murder. For example, in 1991, Njeri published an autobiography called My Life with the Black Panther Party, where she speaks about the night Hampton was killed. She's also the chairperson of the December 4th committee, which, and I quote, fights to defend and maintain the legacy of the Black Panther Party and what really happened on that fateful morning of Hampton and Mark Clark's assassination. As a result, Njeri has continued the legacy of the revolutionary Black Panther Party, which I would like to highlight was completely led by teenagers and young adults. She said, "I used to say that if I gave up, the ghost of Chairman Fred would haunt me to this day, because we're still not free. Power to the people has not become a reality." She is an inspiration to me because of the actions and changes she created and fought for throughout her life. She embodies unrelenting strength in the face of horrid traumatic events, extreme stress, and great adversity. She is an inspiration to me. More importantly, she is an example of how when young people are equipped with a purpose, determination, and resilience, they can completely change our world. Thank you.
Wow, thank you very much, Brianna. Next, we have Abby Alexandre, and she will be presenting on Marley Dias.
Hi, my name is Abby Alexandre. I am a junior at Bunnell High School in Stratford, Connecticut, and I decided to do my presentation on Marley Dias. Marley Dias is a 16-year-old activist for diverse representation in children's books. When Marley was just 11 years old, she loved to read books all day and flipping through endless pages of excitement. But as she started to grow up, she noticed that all the books that were given to her at school and that she was reading only had main characters who were white and had no form of diverse representation in them that she could relate to. So Diaz later set out a plan to change that. In November 2015, she launched a campaign called #1000BlackGirlBooks. Her goal was to collect and donate 1,000 books that featured Black girls as the main character. And today she has collected more than 9,000 books with Black girls that are featured as the main character. In an interview with Forbes, she explained that frustration is the fuel that can lead to the development of an innovative and useful idea. And she used that same frustration to help her movement grow. Studies have shown that only 8.4 of 3,400 trade books published in 2016 had African-American main characters in them as in the books. Percentage went even lower for Latino and American Indian, and so far with Asian and Pacific Islander. And that the ones that featured Latino and Native American characters in the starring role only had 5% in them. This huge gap affects all of us, and it should not be so hard to create a safe space for everyone from different backgrounds to be involved in showcased in different children literature books. And I chose to write about this because as a Black girl myself, I think it's very important for diverse children to grow up reading books that they can relate to. And I think it's important for them to read it and be comfortable with it and help with make it more interesting for them to read.
Thank you so much. I mean, there's, you know, some conversation in the chat, but at 11 years old, that's incredible. Last but not least, we have our youngest activist, revolutionary of the group's presentations today. And so with that, Janaya Riley will present on Ruby Bridges.
Hi guys. So yes, I'm Janaya. I'm a junior in basically 11th grade. I go to Ludlow, Sophia for Ludlow High School. And I decided to surround tonight for me for with Ruby Bridges. So Ruby Bridges was born in Tylertown, Mississippi in 1954. She is an American activist who became one of the many symbols of the civil rights movement. She's one of the oldest of eight children who was born into poverty in Mississippi. And when she was 4 years old, her parents moved down to New Orleans. And it's notable to understand that, like, during this time period with the 1900s, African-Americans lacked opportunities like with education. So because of their race, African-Americans had to fight for everything that they had. And 2 years later, a test was given to African-American school children to determine who was allowed to enter white schools. Yes, like, this was a literal test that they took. And Ruby Bridges herself didn't agree with this. So at the age of six, the youngest of a group of African Americans managed to integrate, like herself, Ruby Bridges, into the school in the American South. And this was well known as the school she attended, which was William France Elementary School. There she had proved that you can never be too little or too young to fight for a rightful cause. And she also, despite the fact that her family went through suffering, like the hatred that she had gotten, like the discrimination, everything, her bravery exhibited with her dedication, not only to herself and her family, but overall with the whole nation in general, especially in where she was living, which was the South. And later in life, Bridges had took a turn as she got older to become involved in writing books about the experiences as a young girl that she experienced it. And she exploited what happened in the 1960s, even about a teacher that she had had during that year. So why do we honor Ruby? We honor her because she's not only a great representation of African-American empowerment, but like I said before, despite facing a crowd of angry white citizens, especially being so young, she managed to overcome all of that and continue to pave the way for equal access to education for the generations of African-American students. And she fought rightfully and strongly And without her, the nation wouldn't be what it kind of is today, and what we know as influencers, like throughout the whole slideshow, what we're kind of representing. And I wanted to share a painting that was done by Norman Rockwell, and it's called The Problem We Live With. And it exhibits, you can see Ruby right behind us, I wouldn't say a screen, but like the background of that yellow wall. And you could see there's what explicit, like a blood splatter. And then you could see the N word all in the back, which is a slur that a lot of African-Americans had been called. And it's basically just exhibiting her being escorted by US Marshals from the violence she was facing. And many don't know that it was actually inspired by Ruby herself. But yeah, that's where that kind of comes from. So you can see four different figures in there. And one, like I said, which is Ruby.
Excellent. Thank you, Janiyah. So actually, thank you to all of our amazing presenters this evening, just dropping some knowledge for our guests. At this point, we are gonna move into our student performances. And so up first from our student performances is, give me one second, Jalil. Jalil Harris is up first.
I'd like to say, can everybody hear me? Everybody can hear me? Okay, thank you. First, I'd like to say, I'd like to really thank SEJ for giving me this opportunity to express myself in how I feel with this piece I wrote. And like, I'll take any criticism, like for me, or like compliments you want to send me in direct messages. But here I go. Home of the misdemeanors and felonies and gun violence, but provided it's two-sided, you see black on black violence. I see my brothers dying, like I see mindsets like poverty stopping me. I see home invasions, robberies, larcenies. Federal charges are even hard to see. Keep us in a broken community. It's like a policy constantly. See, my brothers die of anxiety. Actually, take a step back and think of this reality. No handcuffs. No handcuffs. Melanin in my skin. They really hate me. Crazy. This get me stumped. How we contribute to almost all American history and only got one Black History Month? This is enough. I don't get it. It just conniving. How we gonna fight each other in the killer virus? We started a revolution. And then we tyrants, all because we speak Black Lives Matter. You ignore that to keep your silence, just be quiet. And it's casual. They think we unfathomable. The way they compare mostly peaceful protests to people that stormed the Capitol. And I scream this in our capitals and wear Black Lives Matter on my sleeve like it's fashionable. Black power.
Wow, I gotta catch my breath for a minute. Thank you, Julia. Wow. I wanna save my comment for the comment section because I don't wanna be the only one that gets to express herself, but that gave me chills. Moving piece. Next, we have Marquise McCullough. Marquise is presenting his drawing.
Yes. I'm sorry. I have to find it.
Marquise, you're on mute. You have to unmute yourself.
I'm so sorry. I'm trying to find it. Please. All right.
Mate.
Marquise, you muted yourself again.
Yes, I'm so sorry.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Ooh, I love this filter. Hello, everyone. My name is Marquise McCullough. I am a recent graduate of 2020, and
I will be presenting an art. I will show it right now because I have it in my sketchbook. And I will also present words as well. I have it in my notes. Okay, all right. All right, I'm ready. My name is Marquise McCullough, and I am an actor and artist of color. For Black History Month, I want to talk about inspiration of color and who have inspired me and others and my own inspiration. Before I started acting, I originally started drawing, and I started at the age of 11 years old, and I still do to this day, and I'm 20. I was inspired by my big brother named Tyron, and I mainly draw Pokemons and cartoon characters that I can try. After middle school, I had to start high school, and I wanted to choose co-op. But co-op reminded me of Victorious because all the students in co-op were crazy talented. And everybody told me to try visual arts, and I wanted to do something different with myself. I wanted to go for acting. I wanted to go for acting because people have inspired me in TV shows and that actors are themselves, and I am myself as well. I'm glad that I've made the decision of acting because I've gained the experience and that I would like to continue it in the future. People that you meet give you motivation, power, and confidence. There are famous celebrities of color who have made their mark in history of the world. I'm proud that I am an artist and actor of color and still is growing and developing of who I am and want to be. I am Marquise McCullough, and I am a blossom who will continue to grow. I have quotes as well that I would like to share. Well, one. I put, life as an actor slash artist is like a TV show. As seasons go by of numbers, people will grow up to be like flowers and continue to blossom.
Thank you, Marquise. Thank you for sharing your visual art, but also I think what you would share with us is almost a piece of poetry. And so thank you very much for that.
And up next, I'm sorry, I was rushing, I'm sorry.
No, it was wonderful, don't apologize. You did an awesome job. And you know, it's like you're multi-talented. So we got to see your work, but also hear your work. So thank you, Marquise, you were awesome.
Thank you.
Up next, we have Brianna Mondesir presenting an original piece.
Hi, everyone. Today I'm going to be reading a poem called How to Lose the Weight. Begin. Eating when your grandma says to eat. Eating when your grandma says to eat. Cramming when your grandma says to eat. Gorging when your grandma says to eat. Heaving a fit when she says you've gained weight and need to go for a walk. Go on the walk. Your extra white rice, black beans, and fried chicken thighs rubbing together the entire time. Apologize to the black and brown contour lines cinching your waist that you mistook for burnt bacon. Imagine a silver lining among those dark streaks. Pause. Show your mom. Tell her you believe it is cancer. Shock your mom. For every tiny piece of too round, too heavy comment since you were 8 years big and she said you couldn't be a ballerina. Apologize when she begins to sob. All right, you'll quit your comedian day job. Play dead as a pink crayfish submerged underneath the toasty sand, a letter scrawled across your stomach. I did not eat the shrimp and chicken Alfredo spaghetti. I did not eat the second bowl of turkey soup. I did not eat the styrofoam wrapped chocolate strawberries. I did not eat. When your aunt finds you, burn up this letter with crunches. Weigh yourself with your mom's scale, teetering on the glass. Don't cut yourself on the edge. Remember, it is broken. Thank you.
Wow. Again, so much talent. Oh my gosh, you guys are awesome. and just the vulnerability that it takes, you know, to be able to open yourself up. So thank you all to our beautiful artists. Last but not least, we have Benny Sumbu, who who is going to share a piece of her art with us.
Hello, everyone. Thank you all for coming. I'm going to share a piece of mine. It's a little poem. It's untitled for now, but I hope you guys enjoy. Okay. I was born in the heart of Africa, nurtured betwixt the bosom of Mother Earth, fighting to be unleashed into the world, brought to heal and love, born to lead a revolution against the oppressive forces that have enslaved an entire planet. Breaker of chains, I am a freedom fighter. My bones are laced with liberation. My blood pumps for salvation. Fire was etched into my DNA. A phoenix ready to burn and rise again with love and move forward as such. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Benny. Again, thank you to all of our beautiful artists and for sharing your amazing work. At this point, we are going to move into our conversation. So Steph, will you guide us and take it away?
Yeah, of course. So once again, I just like to appreciate all the young people who presented just now, and your artwork was amazing. It was just very inspiring. Oh gosh, why is that working like that? But anyways, talking about inspiring, I'd like to shout out to one of the artists that we just had who inspires me as a young person. Brianna is a young person who I always find very inspiring. And when I first met her, she opened a lot of things to me. Because at the time, I wasn't aware of myself, and I thought I was like taught and ingrained to myself that I can't do such things until I'm older. I can't, you know, go to college till I'm older. I can't really write a book or do my own things while I'm older. I can't start a company until I'm older. But Brianna did all of that already at like around my age. I think she's only 2 years older than me, and she already accomplished so much, and she showed me what a young person can do. So I'd like to ask the audience if you guys could like shout out someone who inspires you or has inspired your work. And what did they do that inspired you? But if you'd like to go, please make sure to raise your hand, which is a button on the Zoom, which you can find if you click on to participants. And it should be next to a button called yes and no. But anyways, I'd also like to pass it to Janaya. Janaya, who's someone who inspires you?
Thank you, Stephanie. So there's actually a lot of people that inspire me, but one person that definitely has had an impact on my overall with like activism and my work, which I love advocating for myself and others, raising awareness and whatnot, is Andrew McInnes, which he's actually a student and a friend at the school I go to, Ludlow. I met Andrew my sophomore year, and I remember kind of getting involved with like a little bit of activism in a equity group that I was in. And I remember this year, being a junior now, I had seen like it was this agenda that he had, and I knew Andrew had like so much always going on. Like he worked, he did a whole bunch of like volunteering, he was in everything. So I one day I was like, and what is in that? But like, and he showed me like the amount of stuff like he was in and why he did it. And from that point on, it kind of motivated me to not only like get myself involved, but also not just saying like, oh, just because he does it, that, you know, I kind of just brought myself to a point where it was like, if I want something to make a change in like overall life, especially being in a predominantly white school, I wanted to make a change like overall. So not just like within my school with like the slurs that we got and like the name changes and whatnot. So he's a person that actually inspired me for that. And now I'm actually in a lot of involvement with like clubs and organizations like SEJ, But in our school, I'm in Youth for Equity, and I'm a leader of that. So I want to pass it over to Benny to hear about like what has inspired you and your work.
Yeah, Emma Gonzalez really inspires me. They were one of the survivors of the Parkland shooting that happened a couple years ago. And just seeing how they responded to that and the way that they addressed the adults and like how they handled the situation and their lack of action when it comes to gun control laws. And also just like how unapologetic they are when it comes to expressing themselves. That also really inspired me to use my voice as, or to try to use my voice as unapologetically as they do. Their boldness and authenticity really makes me excited about the future of youth activism. And Cheryl in the chat, please let me know if I'm pronouncing your name wrong, but they responded by saying that their grandmother also inspires them and young people. So thank you for putting that in there. All right.
Cheryl,
okay, thank you. All right, so recently we've had many examples of youth activism in the last couple of years with the Black Lives Matter movement, the anti-gun violence movement, and overall the fight against oppressive systems. So I really would like to know like what excites y'all about the future of youth activism and leadership. Audience, also you can be a part of this conversation as well. If you wanna add your response, you can put it in the chat or use the raise your hand feature and y'all can join in. But Janaya, do you wanna answer this?
Yeah, so just to keep it kind of short and simple about kind of what excites me about the future of youth activism is definitely being someone that can say like what you've accomplished with so young, as someone that was just previously said, like what Brianna, she accomplished a lot while being so young. And it kind of also creates a positive role model to put forefront for the future generation, especially when and previous generations, like even seen within the slideshow, like these people, we've been experiencing a lot of different problems throughout society, one of them being discrimination. And you see that even with these activists that they have pushed forward and pushed through regardless of the hardships that they've experienced. So I feel like for the future for youth activism and leadership is really kind of replicating what was done before, but pushing through even stronger and pushing through to the best that you can. It's going to be hard at times. Nothing is easy, and it wasn't easy for these activists either. It's not something that happens overnight, but things like what we do here is just sharing our thoughts, sharing what we've learned, educating others is what we want to kind of continue on with that legacy. So yeah, as we said, we want to see if any of the audience has any answers or even wants to add on to what's being said.
I believe you should be able to unmute yourself if you want to comment on anything.
Alex in the chat says, we inspire them. Thank you. Okay, you don't have to go. We can move on. All right, some things.
Anthony has their hand raised.
Oh, go ahead. I didn't see.
Sorry, I didn't want to, since I wanted to give audience a chance to speak. Sorry. But one thing I'm looking forward to is that this movement is one that is like, it's one that builds off momentum. And so it's one that has, we didn't just like, we took it up, but it's been going strong for like the past few decades. And I really think that's impressive. And one thing that might actually, I'm looking forward to see is how we do the movement and how organized we are after COVID. Because I feel like, even though I'm not gonna say this year has been good for us, but I feel like this year has brought to light some things that we could work on, like communication, different ways of organizing and different ways of actually progressing the movement, even when we're not in person to do that. And also I think it just gives like this sense of urgency that we kind of not needed, but it helps kind of like make us aware of like what we gotta do. And like, we're not on a time trial, but we wanna get this thing rolling. So I like that. And I can't wait to see how that goes on.
Yes. And speaking of that, like, we also want to talk about, like, what young people should keep in mind as they move forward in this work. And also, audience, feel free to join in on this. One example that, or one thing that I do want to talk about a little bit is, like, keeping in mind how adults can easily, like, take over, like, the work that young people do. I think back to the work that we were doing advocating for PA 1912, which is an act of an inclusion of African American and Latinx studies into Connecticut high schools. It'll be implemented in the next couple of years. During that process, we all, if not most, if not all of the young people that were advocating for this bill wanted this bill to pass with the amendments that would make it into a history of race and racism, that would require teachers to get training, that would require a committee be specifically delegated to overseeing the implementation of this course. But you know, the young people that were like saying this stuff weren't being heard because the bill was passed and none of the amendments that we wanted got implemented into the bill. So that was just one example. Anyone else?
I have a quick question about, like, when is the bill supposed to be, like, put into place? Like, when are the studies supposed to be in classes?
By 2022, I believe, it should be in classes.
Oh, yeah, Benny. I also remember that as well. I remember doing all that. I also remember testifying as well with other SCJ members, including Anthony and you, Benny. And I don't know if any other members who are presently here were part of that.
Something else to keep in mind, like, as we move forward in this activism is, like, not letting it take over our lives so far as, like, it becoming a toxic, like, environment for ourselves. Like, I can talk about, like, how I was overworked, you know, I was overworking, like, a lot, you know, trying to get all of this work, and I'm, like, glad I did it, and it paid off, but, you know, at the same time, like, my mental health took a really severe hit doing that, so, like, young people are forward in this, it's really important that you prioritize your wellness, your mental health, and making sure that you're taking care of yourself, because, you know, this work isn't going to be done in a day, it's not going to be over, you know, in an hour, you know, so, you know, it's going to be continued, yeah. And it's not, you know, up to us to just, like, take on all of the burdens. It's okay to take care of yourself and let others sort of pick up the mantle sometimes.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, Janine, you want to go?
Oh, wait, Stephanie, where are you going?
No.
I just wanted to say someone in the audience has their hand raised.
Oh, really? Oh, I'm sorry, I don't know how to say your name.
It's okay. Hey, Stephanie. It's Amaryllis. We met before.
Hey, Amaryllis.
Thanks, Anthony, for catching it. One thing I want to just, you know, say is, like, I'm seeing, my name is Amaryllis, she, her pronouns. I'm seeing, right, Brianna here, and I'm seeing Benny, right? And so when I think about youth organizing, right, and you're talking about, right, like, all these folks who've done it in the past, right, like, one of the things I think about is, like, how do you sustain, like, interest in your movement through your organization over time, right? So, like, you have high school students, and then you have folks who are post-high school, right, who may be in school or maybe going into the world of work, right? But, like, you know, my question for you at SCJ is, like, how are y'all thinking about, right, like, you know, sustaining and retaining your, like, your members, right? Because one of the things that's hard about youth organizing is that you have, like, a small period of time to do the work, and then people kind of go on their own. And one of the things I appreciate about y'all is that you have sustained interest and membership of youth who are out of the high school age. So I'm just wondering, like, one, like, how have you all kind of figured that out, how to keep, you know, folks engaged past high school, and, like, why is that important for, like, building power?
That's such a good question. And that's something that we are also, like, trying to figure out, like, a specific process on how to do that. But I think an important factor that I think has worked for us is really, like, the relationships that we've cultivated in this org.
like that's the reason like I'm still here, because I love Rashonda, I love Rihanna, I love Kara, like I love everyone being here. So for me, it's like I'm just working with friends, and this is like a space where I really feel like I am able to be myself and connect with other people. And so I think that's like a really core part of retaining membership and just like interest and passion.
But also, Benny, you are working on another arm, which you might want to just mention.
Oh, yeah. Also working on like, you know, cultivating pride within young people so that they have the confidence and the strength to like feel like, oh, I can do this on my own. Like I can come back and like make, you know, choices and be a leader and all of that. And I think that's really important, because like when I think back to when I first joined SEJ, like I was complete opposite of who I am now. Like I would never have done this like 3-4 years ago. And so I think that cultivating pride, that instilling confidence, that empowerment is really important for like also helping students like keep that passion and keep coming back. Because I mean, if you don't feel like you can do it, if you don't feel proud of yourself, if you don't feel confident in yourself, then you're not gonna wanna do it again.
That's funny, because I was actually, that is so important, but that's not what I was talking about. Oh. The alumni engagement that you're literally working on.
Yeah. Well, that's what I meant by like the process that we're creating. Like we're trying to create a more like structured process to keep members coming back. So.
Chime in just for a minute, because it like that is real, that like, you know, after high school graduation, a lot of our members, you know, will go off to another state for college, you know, some stay local, but even still, when you're starting college, it's like it's a whole new experience. And so one of the things that we center like their educational experience, right? We never want to like interfere the SEJ work to interfere with their, you know, responsibilities and things within their educational experience. But the hope is that like, you know, once they get settled into college and figure out their schedules and, you know, the things that they're going to be active in, then they, you know, will return to us. And we try to, you know, maintain those relationships and ensure that like, you know, they have what they need, that, you know, a lot of our members are like first generation college students. I myself was one. And so, you know, just like have, you know, ensuring that like you like whatever you might need or questions you might have answered. Like I know my predecessor Hillary was like, you know, with Brianna really active and like helping her select a college and talking about like majors and stuff like that. So we try, even though they leave us, you know, they're not fully gone. We try to just keep them, even if it's not, you know, not even if they don't like engage in like SEJ organizing, they know that they always have a home and they can just return whenever. I hope that that's what like our graduates feel like when they leave.
Thank you, Rashonda, for that. I definitely hope for that too. I know I'm a junior, so I didn't graduate yet, but I definitely hope for that. I want to ask you guys another question the audience can't answer for this, but what can we do to uplift and center the experiences of young activists in the field of activism? So what do you guys think about that?
Kira, would you like to go?
Yes. So I think one of the things that at least, you know, adults and older people can do is listen. I think that's super important, because sometimes we get caught up in talking in circles around each other or talking over other people, or, you know, acting like their experiences aren't as legitimate. And instead, sometimes we can just stop and listen, realize we don't know everything, and that some people, no matter what age they are, they know a little more, or they know what's going on a little better, or how to talk to people a little better.
Yeah, I agree, Kira.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that also, Kira, with that kind of like helping us overall also like lead and make connections and help us get those resources, those people, because that can definitely have an impact overall.
Amarellis asked a question for you, Janaya. She asked, how do you define activism? Because there's an ongoing debate about the difference between activism and organizing.
Okay, so activism to me, just to keep it kind of simple and short, I just feel like activism is something that like you're dedicated to. Organizing, because you said, Benny, that's the other thing you said, right? Organizing. Did you say that? Or maybe I heard it wrong. You said between activism is...
Oh, yeah. For the question, yeah. She said there's an ongoing debate between activism and organizing.
Yeah. So I just feel like activism is just dedication to something you want to, like, make a change on. I feel like kind of, like, propose and, like, put a lot of thought and something that you want to have an impact on and, like, see something over that. Between like, yeah, organizing, just a little bit of clarification. When you mean organizing, do you mean like when there's stuff like this going on, like where we kind of organize something together, and like educate people, like how we're doing now and kind of like creating conversation? Is that what you're kind of talking about? Cause I feel like you can also use campaigning to bring about political and social change. But that's something else that's kind of key to activism, kind of defining it.
Right. Thank you for clarifying. I was just asking because like, if I show up to like a protest, right, I'm an activist, right? And if I'm part of a like membership group in a campaign, I'm a community organizer. And so there's this like, sometimes that's conflated right now. We have found like that most young people are in the activism sphere. So they're like showing up to actions, but they're not as much as part of like organized groups that are working towards a campaign and a membership base. So I was just wondering, because you were asking the audience like what you meant by activism. So we're responding based on the definition you all have versus our own.
Would you like to go, Anthony? I saw you raised your hand.
Like I'm taking up too much space, but I was actually thinking about this beforehand of like how someone can be an activist without organizing, because as like someone brought up before, I think it was Amarillo's, how I'm a senior, Stephanie, you're a senior, and soon we're gonna be in college soon, and like I was thinking, how can I still fight for what I believe in and fight for change even though I'm not here for the organizing effort? And then I just realized that like organizing is a, it's something that you could do to, how do I say, it's like an outlet for activism, I think of it as, because you could be an activist and like affect something in a different kind of way, like philanthropy or something like that. So that's why I think like for me, activism is like something that you could take in different routes, and organizing is just one route that is like, has a big like impact, but it's not the only way you could go about it. So, yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks,
Anthony. I think, yeah, that really, you're right. Like you can be an activism without organizing, and you can, and if you are an organizer, you are an activist. For our next question, this also the audience, feel free to answer as well. Like how can young people and adults work together? And what are some, how can young people and adults work together? Stephanie, do you want to go?
Well, I'm sorry, what did you say?
You want to answer that?
Yeah. Okay. Young and pop, I'm not sure actually. How about what you guys say?
I think young people could definitely work with adults if the adults understand that young people also have a lot to contribute and a lot to contribute and that their voice matters and has values to it, and that there are going to be moments where young people should take the lead and like adults should follow in that and give support whenever they need it. Janai, you want anything to add?
Yes, I could definitely add something with that. So
I feel like young people and adults can work together in little ways that can build into something like bigger. So like sharing your thoughts about something, even as I previously said, like having those people, because yes, you can do a lot when you're younger, but sometimes having those higher, higher figures, meaning like I know in my school for equity, for youth for equity, we have a principal on our call sometime. We have superintendents on our calls. We have support from adults. We have support from students. We have support from overall and help. So it's no age requirement, no age limit to gaining help or receiving help and support overall if you want to make a change. And some possible issues that I see young people facing with like activism and leadership sometimes can even be finding your spot where you feel like you're included. A lot of times, some people know what they want to do. Like, I want to fight for LGBTQ rights. I want to fight for standardized testing to be not counted, or curriculum change, which you'll see later on. And the further question, where we discuss that with curriculum and how that kind of has a toll overall. But yeah, stuff like that, sometimes people don't know how to get involved. And that's where sometimes those people, those young people or adults kind of come into play and can help you, guide you to the right lanes to get to where you want to be so you can feel extra included and extra impactful to make a change.
Can I ask a question? I wonder if there are any adults on with us who might share how they work with young people.
Anyone? I can go. So I am a research assistant with the National Latino Network. If you know Lily Macias, I work for her. So with one of the projects that I'm new on, which is the Youth Participatory Action Photo Voice Research Project, pretty much what we're doing is we're giving the youth the reins. We're kind of just giving you the tools to, and kind of the instructions of, hey, this is the general direction we're going in, and then letting them have full creative freedom and also picking, you know, the topics that are most important that you want to focus on. And I feel like that's, especially after hearing some of your opinions and beliefs and everything, I feel like even more so that's the best way to do it, because like a few of you have already said, you know, sometimes adults don't really give youth the voice. And if it's a youth-led project, why don't you have the entire voice? So that's just, you know, my experience so far, you know, getting that project going. And so far, I think it's going well with some of the sites that we've done it with, so.
Thank you. All right, we're almost done, y'all. Our second to last question is also for the audience as well. So as young people, we are often told by adults that as we get older, the radical ideas that we once held as youth will fade away and will inevitably become conservative. So to the adults in this room, is that true? Like, do you know people who have become more conservative as they aged? And why do you think that is? Or are we just being hoaxed? So this is for the adults in the room if they want to answer.
Can you say the first part of the question again?
Yeah, so as young people, we are often told by adults that as we get older, our once radical ideas that we held as youth will become conservative as we get older. And we're just wondering, like, is that true? And why does that happen? Or why are we told that?
I can add in a thought. I call myself the nice term of a tweener. But one thing that I definitely think about is that I think with young people, there's more of a vitality, a force for change that, while not necessarily going away as you get older, it's really hard to maintain
and to continue over a long time, especially with the realities of burnout and just stress. And then I also think about kind of with my presentation on Akua Najari of how, you know, as she got older, she also had to consider her child, for example, and how, you know, not saying that young people don't have children or other responsibilities, but generally as you get older, there's sometimes more things you have to consider, while when you're a young person, you might just be able to, you know, yourself might be able to be more of a priority than other factors and whatnot. So that's what I'm thinking.
What do the adults say?
I could add my two cents again. I kind of also technically fall into the in-between because I'm like a former young person. Like, I'm old enough to not be considered a young person, but too young to be considered like old. But I would say in my experience, it's kind of like a generational myth, where I agree with what Brianna said as far as, you know, the younger generations, like mine and younger, just have a lot more passion and force. And I think that a lot of the generations before us kind of didn't push for social change as much. It was not as widespread as it is now. But I also agree, yes, like priorities change as you get older and things like that. But I think that there's just more of an internal passion that these kinds of things, where we're not really with the mentality of, oh, if it doesn't have to deal with us, then I don't have to deal with it. Like, it's kind of more of, no, like, this still occurs in my community, whether it's related to my identity or not, I still care about it. So I guess short answer is, I don't think it's true anymore, maybe for, you know, older generations, but not so much anymore.
Well, speaking of,
I'm sorry, Janaya, I think Georgia wants to chime in on this particular question before you move on.
Oh, yeah.
So I am old. I'm going to put myself in the old category right now. So I feel like I'm bringing that like voice in. So I actually really agree with what both of you were saying, Brianna and Jordan. I think, you know, and I think it actually, you know, certainly I have a lot of friends who have gone conservative, like, you know, used to rally around. And I think some of it is tied to like income, right? Like, and responsibility and whatnot, right? And I would actually say, and I think it's also partially getting like, I mean, knocked down a lot of times, right? Where you have this kind of idealism and then over time just getting knocked down, it can slightly get whittled away. And what I would just say is that there's you know, one sometimes needs to make a really conscious decision to continue to get up and keep doing it every single day. And it can sometimes feel really hard. And I suspect as youth, you all, you know, young people, you feel like that too, right? But I would say it's just, again, it's that repetition of getting knocked down that can often turn people to be a little bit less, you know, kind of passionate. That said, I would agree that I think one of the key moments that happened this year, and I'm sorry, I can't remember the person who said it, but basically I think the fact that many of us stuck in our houses, really like seeing what was happening, really attentive, not distracted by work and other responsibility, made this kind of a year where we, you know, a lot of people's fires got relit around the social justice work. And the big question is like how to maintain that after everybody starts going back to work and kind of the distractions of responsibilities get back and kind of start distracting people.
Okay, y'all. So thank you for sharing, Georgia. That was awesome. And kind of like what you were saying, what that, what's it called? Then, what is it? The enforcement, when you were like doubting and whatnot. Where did it go? Hold on. Okay. To add on to everything, what do you guys think about, my fault. Even with the young leaders and everything, and what we learn about, we're not told about how young they truly are. And it's almost as if adults don't want us to recognize the power and use it. And sorry, I was like all over the place there for a second, but yeah, that was just to add on to that. And we should celebrate young people in schools, which isn't acknowledged a lot.
Hey, that's all we have for y'all today. Go ahead.
I lost my thought when Georgia said something. You had said about like that knockdown part. That's what I was trying to talk about before. So kind of like the discouragement. I feel like that's kind of how I took what you said, Georgia, and then added on with that.
So I know we're just about wrapping up, but there's like this whole like excellent chat moment that's happening right now. And so I just want to highlight that. Amaryllis said, many adults who are directly connected by the issues continue to organize because their survival depends on it. And I had said, like, I didn't want to chime in while this discussion was happening, but I wanted to question the source, many of that, of, you know, when you make that statement, because I agree with what Amaryllis said. Not that, you know, like you become, like for some, this is our livelihoods. Like we're just trying to survive. So you don't lose that fire. You don't become less radical. And then Kiera made a really wonderful point where she says, I do wonder why that happens. One example is John Lewis, rest in peace, going from protesting, being arrested and talking about getting into good trouble to kind of suggest that young people should be more respectful and less rebellious. And so that answers the question that I was asking in my mind to you, Benny, of like where you got that statement. Kiera presented a really good example of it. And so I just wanted us to acknowledge, Amaryllis writes, good trouble is about making trouble from the inside. We all eventually become complicit once employed by institutions. And so there's something to be said in that whole exchange that took place. And I just wanted to make sure that is not lost on anyone because part of it I think is burnout and fatigue. Some of it might be capitalism and you just trying to get yourself and your family up and out of it. And then others of us, it's about survival and like ongoing, it will never stop. That's just food for thought. Maybe we could have like round two and focus on that. But I just wanted everybody to see, you know, that really, like in just a few moments, powerful exchange that took place.
Yes, thank you for having me, Rashonda.
Hi, I'm back. Just as to wrap up our event a little bit and to let y'all know what SCJ is up to these days, we're working on our current campaign, which is to defund and replace all the school resource officers in New Haven public high schools with institutionalized mental health support, which will manifest as either a social worker or guidance counselor in every high school. And yeah, our young people are grinding at this work right now. And if you're interested in learning more or getting involved, please reach out and let us know. But with that, thank you so, so much for coming, sharing your wisdom and your time. Some people have been DMing me, telling me that the young people, you guys are amazing and that you guys did a wonderful, wonderful job. So keep it coming for our young people who were presented tonight. And thank you for being here. Make sure to follow us on social media. Go to our website to learn more about us. Reach out to me if you want to learn more about what we're doing with defunding the police. But that's it for tonight. Thank you guys so much for coming.
One last thing, I just want to say for those who work with young people, SCJ has a winter student support form where we're offering support and for a variety of resources. I didn't prepare, so I'm not ready to drop the link in the chat, but it's on our social media. So if you know young people who are in need of, you know, anything from like sanitary products to books and school supplies, please let them know that we are offering support with the help of Yale's New Haven Community Fund.
Thanks, y'all. And we will be playing y'all out with a song from the recent movie, Judas and Black Messiah, and highlighting some additional young activists we weren't able to talk about fully tonight. But thank you so much for coming. Have a great rest of your night. Thank you
and
for
thank
coming.
Thank you, Alexa. Oh my God, you are hashtag mood right now.
Thank you.
Oh, I love you. To our planning team, can you please stay on for just like 10, 15 minutes? And everybody else, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Yes.
Yes, guys. Thank you.